Let me start my countdown thing here. I'm Duncan Foley. This is the New School for Social Research in the spring of 2016. This course is Advanced Microeconomics 2, Information and Behavior in Political Economy. This is the last class, actually, and it's a kind of an extra. It goes into a little bit more abstract questions of the philosophy of science and theory choice. But since it's the last class, I'd just like to take a tiny minute to thank Red Dog Productions and all the people who have put time in to this project from their end. It's been a great experience for me and a great thing to have happen. What this material is about is a more abstract way of thinking about how do you construct theories and how do you choose among theories. So in a certain sense, it's more of an econometrics topic, although it's at a very abstract enough level that we won't get into very much nitty-gritty econometrics. And the material is more abstract, so I really encourage you to ask questions to clarify and make me try to give you examples if things are not instantly recognizable. The general title is Effective Complexity and Theory Choice because the model that I use of a theory comes from a paper by Murray Gell-Mann and Seth Lloyd called Effective Complexity, and I'll explain their idea along the way, and I develop it somewhat. So that's the title. Okay, so I think the best way to start this is to go back almost to the very beginning of the course, which was Shannon's theorem and information theory, and to remind you of a couple of things that we might have learned if we remember that, if our memory is that long. Bill Clinton, I think, once said that the memory of the public, political public, is 2 weeks. So I don't know how long the memory of graduate students in economics is, but I've noticed that there's a certain tendency for knowledge to depreciate over time as you get farther and farther from the first time you saw it. But let's go back and just review it for a second. That Shannon's theorem, one way to think about Shannon's theorem is that it establishes a very close mathematical or conceptual relationship between information theory and probability or frequency distributions. And the basic idea of this is that the if you have a assignment of frequencies, say to messages in information theory, then Shannon's theorem says that the code word that you assign to that particular message has a length is close to the negative of the log of the frequency of the message. That's the optimal coding that minimizes the average message length or maximizes the information transmission. So you want to think that when you see a probability, you take its logarithm and the negative of its logarithm. Let's say you take the logarithm to the base 2, that is a number of bits, and that is the number of bits that you would assign to the optimal code word for that particular item if you were thinking of transmitting it as a message. Want to be able to go back and forth that way very conceptually without too much of a hitch, okay, that talking about bits is really a way of talking about probabilities or frequencies. So that means that the Bayesian posterior probability distribution can be understood as a way of coding the information in data. And the idea here is that we're going to use a theory or a hypothesis in the Bayesian sense as a model of the data. So we're thinking about the philosophy of science now almost as if it is Shannon's information theory. You have collected some data. Maybe you is the whole human race, or it's Tycho Brahe who looked from his observatory and recorded where the planets were over a long period of time, and Kepler got hold of that data, or it's you've looked it up in the census data of economic data from the census. Anyway, you have some data, and your problem is to convey that data to me. Okay, I'm the receiver, you're the transmitter. So there's a communication channel. And the way you're going to do it is to send me some kind of string of bits. Now, one of the ways you can do this is that you could just code the bits in computer characters. So you could, in fact, some people tend to write thesis chapter drafts this way. You get about 3 pages of discussion, and then you get big tables, which are just their raw data. Okay? And that's, in a way, that's research. I mean, they're conveying the data to you. But it's not very easy to read, and it's not very easy to learn from if you just see a bunch of raw data like that. If you have this, so we're thinking of the data as a string, okay, in the abstract sense. So it's just a big string of bits that is codes in some way or other, whatever it is that you happen to know. And in fact, in the modern world, data most often is going to be a string of bits. It's going to be an Excel spreadsheet or something like that, which sits on your computer as just a string of bits, right? A whole string of bits that's organized in a certain way, but that's the way it is. If there are n bits in this data, and you just transmit it to me in raw form, uncompressed form, you're going to take log to the base 2 of n bits to do that, right? Because that's just how you code information and data. Now, here's the alternative, and this is a possibly new way of looking at things for some people, or maybe you're familiar with this idea. Another way that you might convey to me the data is that you might say, well, this data actually comes from a certain model or a certain theory. So if you're Kepler, you say, well, the theory is that these positions of the planets actually are organized as ellipses, right? That was Kepler's hypothesis. Instead of telling you where in the sky to look for Jupiter or something, I could tell you how big the elliptical orbit of Jupiter is, which takes two numbers, because an ellipse has two dimensions, right? The long axis and the short axis. And I could tell you where around that ellipse the Jupiter is, in, say, some kind of an angle or some measure of how far around it was. And then if I combine that with a description of where the Earth was, then you'll figure out where in the sky to look for Jupiter. So that would be. But that might be a much, much more compact way of conveying our understanding of the orbit of Jupiter than a whole long series of where was Jupiter in the sky in its sky coordinates on a whole bunch of dates over 10 or 100 years or something of that kind. That's the idea of compressing the data through the hypothesis. If you're going to do this, you're going to first transmit the hypothesis. So you're going to use the Shannon code for the prior probability of the hypothesis. We are going to have some agreement about what our probability of hypotheses are. And in order for you to communicate to me which hypothesis it is, you're going to have to code it, right? And if you're a Shannon coder, you're going to code you're going to use a code word based on the prior probability of that hypothesis in the Bayesian sense. What you and I would believe, the degree of belief that we would put in the hypothesis if we didn't know anything and seen any observations of where Jupiter was or what the consumption, marginal propensity to consume was, or whatever it is that we're talking about. Then you might transmit the data given the hypothesis. Well, that's just the Bayesian likelihood, right? So that probability corresponds to another set of bits. Now, it's try to be clear here that what we're doing is taking the model and basing these code words on the probability. So if that data were very unlikely given this hypothesis, for example, you would require a lot of bits to do the likelihood. If, on the other hand, the data were very likely given the hypothesis, so the probability is high, the likelihood is high, then you're not going to use up very many bits to do that because you can assign short code words to data which fit the hypothesis well and therefore are very likely given that hypothesis. If the hypothesis is a good model for the data, the method may save a lot of bits by compressing the data. You want to then think of this as a kind of an alternative you probably have on your computer, a zip program built in. Most computers have the zip program built in. And you know what a zip program does is that it takes a data file and it compresses it to a smaller data file. But it does it in what's called a lossless compression, because the zip program, if it takes the compressed file, can expand it back to the original file with no errors. There are some other computer algorithms, such as JPEG, which are lossy. In other words, the JPEG program compresses the file, but it does it also by discarding some of the information. So if you take a JPEG file, you cannot restore the original exactly in that way. This system is supposed to be a lossless compression system. And the idea of it is that if you get a very good model for the data, then it's going to be able to compress your message to me a lot. What do we mean by a good model? Well, first of all, we want to give a high prior probability to the hypothesis. And we'll talk a little bit about how that might happen. But basically, that's the idea of simplification or elegance of the hypothesis. It shouldn't take very much math or very much description or something to explain this model or this theory to me. So that part is quite short. And if the model fits the data very well, then the probability of the data given the model is going to be very high. And so we're going to get quite a pretty short code word to pick out exactly this string of data in relation to this model. Now, if the model has nothing to do with the data, let's say the model doesn't help at all explain the data, then you don't gain anything from this. Because if the probability of the data given the model is, say, uniform over all data strings of that same type, which means that the model has no explanatory power, then you're not going to get anywhere with this compression scheme, because you're going to wind up back with the log to the base 2 n bits in order to distinguish which particular one of these data strings it is. But if the model's good, this method may result in a lot of compression of the data. Well, let's look at how this works in a little more detail. We can take the logarithms on both sides of Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem says that the probability of a hypothesis given data is equal to the prior probability of the hypothesis multiplied by the likelihood and then divided by a normalizing factor, which is the probability of the data. You take the logarithms, it says the logarithm of the posterior probability of the hypothesis is the logarithm of the prior plus the logarithm of the likelihood plus this effectively constant term, because that doesn't involve the hypothesis at all, right? That's just a constant number that gets added on there. But if we think about this in terms of the point that I made earlier, the negative of the log of P of H, of the log of the prior, is the Shannon code length for the model. And the negative of the log of the likelihood is the Shannon code length of the data given the model. This may give you some insight into why log likelihood comes up in econometrics a whole lot, because it actually is a measure of the fit of the model to the data. And what we would like to do is to pick a hypothesis. So another way of thinking about Bayes' theorem is to say, well, the hypothesis that has the largest posterior probability given the data is going to result in the shortest two-part code for transmitting the data. So it's just another way of reading Bayes' theorem through when we take the logarithms on both sides. Bayes' theorem essentially is saying the same thing as minimize the length of the code that you need, or maximize the compression that the hypothesis allows you to achieve in order to transmit this data. Does anybody have any question about this expression? Because I'm going to be using it a lot in the talk. Okay, well, I'll assume that it's okay, but if something comes up that's puzzling, don't hesitate. One way to talk about this is that this scheme forms what's called a two-part code for the data. And one of the people that has pushed this a lot is a guy named Jorma Riesinen. The original idea goes back into the 1960s with papers from Wallace and Bolton. And as we'll see, a important contribution from a mathematician, Ray Sokolov, which I'll explain in a moment. The two-part code, just to have the idea of the two parts, the first part is when you tell me the model, and the second part is when you tell me the likelihood, the log likelihood, and that then allows me to identify the exact string of data that becomes a code word, the length of a code word for the exact stream of data that you saw. This is sometimes called the minimum description length principle. That's how Riesinen describes it. Now, let's remember a couple of things. Shannon's proof does not specify an algorithm to construct optimal codings. It's an existence theorem. All it says is there is a coding that's optimal, but it doesn't tell you how to find it. There's actually a lot of interesting mathematical work on finding these optimal codes and constructing or approximating optimal codes. But when you've got the Shannon coding, the average code length is going to be the entropy of the frequency distribution. But remember, this frequency distribution is now the posterior probability of the hypothesis given the data. So it includes both the prior and the likelihood elements, the two parts. So here's some examples to try to make this a little more concrete. Suppose that the data that I have, this is a real dumb example, but it's one that's so simple I was hoping it would help. is a number uniformly distributed between 0 and 10. Well, the probability density function for that is dx over 10, where dx is the length of any interval. So if I want to know the probability that the number is in, say, between 1 and 2, then dx is 2 minus 1 is 1, and that's 1/10, right? If I want to know the probability that it's between 3.5 and 4, then the dx is 0.5 divided by 10, and the probability is 1/20, and so forth. So you can keep going along. If we want to transmit the location of the number to one significant digit, that is, I'm just trying to tell you, is it between 0 and 1, or is it between 1 and 2, or between 2 and 3, the uniform distribution assigns a probability of 1/10 to each interval, obviously. Shannon's theorem says, reasonably enough, that we can code this as what? The negative of the log, now we'll take the logs to the base 10 because we're used to operating with decimal digits, of dx over 10 is minus log 10 of dx plus 1, which is 1 digit when dx is equal to 1, because the logarithm of 1 is 0, so you don't need any bits for that, and then I need, or digits for that, and then I just have 1 digit. If we wanted to transmit the location to a second significant digit, so now I want to be able to tell you, is it between 0.1 and 0.2, or 2.1 and 2.2, and so forth. So I'm going to much more fine-grain the data. Then you're going to need 2 digits, because it's the minus, it's negative of the log to the base 10 of dx over 10, but now dx is 0.1. Well, the logarithm of 0.1 to the base 10 is minus 1, right? So the negative minus 1 is 1, so we need 1 digit for that, and then another digit for the to narrow it down a little farther. So this is the kind of, in a very simple case, the kind of operation we're thinking about. Does anybody have any question about that example? Great, okay. Let's go a step further. Suppose we have a number that's normally distributed with mean 0 and standard deviation sigma. Okay, the probability density function is the normal probability density function, 1 over the square root of 2 pi sigma times e to the minus x squared over e to the minus 2 sigma squared dx, right, given the interval dx. To code a number between x and some particular distance plus dx, we require what? Well, we'll now take the logarithms to the base e, because it's easier to do that way, of this probability distribution, of the normal probability distribution. Well, that's the log to the base e of dx over sigma plus 1/2 x over sigma squared, because that's the, when we take the logarithm, that just falls right down, plus 1/2 the log to the base e of 2 pi. Well, that's just a constant, so it doesn't matter. So we get the log e to dx over sigma plus 1/2 x over sigma squared plus this constant number, which happens to be 0.919. And in this case, the information unit are called nats, because we're taking the logarithms to the base e, to the natural, logarithms. And you can see that what's going on is that the length of the code word, this expression here, increases as the square of the size of the number, right? Because you've got this 1/2 x over sigma squared. For example, let's say dx is sigma over 16. So we're looking at intervals that are 1/16 of a standard deviation. We divide up the line into intervals that are 1/16 of a standard deviation. And if the x is actually 2 standard deviations above the mean, above 0, the code word will be 6 nats or 9 bits long, because you can just figure that out from this formula. If dx is sigma over 16 and x is equal to 0, so x is right in the middle of the distribution, has a really high probability, the code word will only be 4 nets or 6 bits long, right, for the same division. Okay, Jose.
Yeah, I was wondering about
maybe we'll get you a microphone. I don't know if they're handing around the microphone.
No, I was wondering what would happen if sigma will start increasing and we start approaching a uniform distribution in this scenario.
Well, you can see that the log e for any given, if we hold dx constant, as sigma becomes bigger and bigger, dx over sigma becomes smaller and smaller, so the logarithm gets bigger and bigger, so you need many more bits to pick out the number. What I'm trying to convey here is this idea that a probability distribution, in this case the probability distribution, is a kind of model of the number. When we originally had the uniform between 0 and 10, that's, we just knew that the number was between 0 and 10. We didn't know anything more. If we know that it's normally distributed with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of sigma, we know a lot more, and as a result, you can code the number with much more efficiency, with a much smaller number of bits. Information theory, in this way, provides a framework for theory choice given data. Theories can be compared in terms of how much they compress given data. And the idea is that the best theory is the one that compresses the data the most. The philosophical principle behind this is called Occam's razor. John of Occam, I think it's John, Roger, I think it's Roger of Occam, was a philosopher in the Middle Ages who kept hammering away at the idea that you should not multiply hypotheses unnecessarily. So the kind of thing that that drove him crazy was somebody said, who chased the cat out of the room? Somebody said, well, the housewife chased the cat out of the room. And then somebody says, I have a better explanation. It was a housewife who was 45 years old and 5 feet 6 inches tall and had red hair who chased the cat out of the room. And Occam said, forget all that. All you really need to know is who chased the cat out of the room, right? So that was the way Occam thought about this. And it's surprising, although it's a very common sense principle, that people in econometrics often lose sight of this problem, of this issue. So if we go back to this logarithmic form of Bayes' theorem, we can see what I have already told you yet again, that the Bayes theorem tells you how much you compress the data, because that's the log, it's proportional to the negative of the log of the posterior distribution. And that exactly coincides with this two-part code, right? The length of the code to transmit the hypothesis and the length of the code to transmit the likelihood. And in order to make this an operational discussion of theory choice, we need a prior over theories. So we need some principle by which we decide what our prior preference over theories is. And secondly, we need to know the likelihood of the data given the theory. The second part is what we tend to spend more time on in economics. You probably sat in many classes where the board is covered with equations, differential equations, describing one model or another, or maybe many models in order, right? So that is all the P of D given H part of it, the likelihood part of it. But there's probably not so much discussion given to the prior probability of the model just by itself. How do you compare models just by themselves? All right, now we have to take a little detour into the history of mathematics, but a very interesting part of the history of mathematics. In the 19th, a mathematician named David Hilbert had a program, which is sometimes called Hilbert's program, which was that he believed that the methods of mathematics, if they were sufficiently well understood and well implemented, could settle the truth or falsehood of any mathematical proposition. So in Hilbert's mind, every stateable mathematical theorem was either true or false. So you should either be able to prove it was true, or you should be able to give a counterexample to show that it was false. He made this one of his famous 20 challenge problems, or I can't remember exactly how many there are, in a lecture that he gave. And this acted as a kind of a Olympic prize for bright young mathematicians to solve one of these Hilbert problems. And one of them was about the decidability of any mathematical proposition. And many great mathematicians, including Kurt Gödel and Alonzo Church and Alan Turing, elaborated formal models of scientific reasoning of this type. All of these models turn out to be pretty much equivalent. And the Turing model is in some ways the easiest, I think, for someone trained in economics rather than abstract mathematics to understand. So we can just work with the Turing idea. It turned out that all of these lines of inquiry came to the same conclusion, which was that Hilbert's program was impossible. That is, that there was not true that the truth or falsity of any stateable mathematical proposition was decidable. And this got expressed in different forms through Gödel's theorem and through Turing, but the Turing one is actually quite straightforward, so we can talk about that. The conclusion, which has been very influential in mathematics and very important, is that it's possible to establish some mathematical propositions as true and false. There are always going to be some that are undecidable in any sufficiently sophisticated system of mathematical axioms. So we can look at Turing's idea to see how he arrived at this. A Turing machine is a model of a computer. Now, it's interesting that Turing invented the Turing machine conceptually before people really had anything much like an actual digital computer. So he was making a model of something that didn't quite exist. It's also interesting if you look at Turing's extremely interesting biography. He's a very, very important person in the history of the 20th century from a whole lot of points of view. He then actually went and developed computers of which his model was a model. So it was one of these inverse things where the model predicted the historical outcome. In Turing's conception, what Turing was trying to think of, Turing was probably pretty autistic, and he reasoned something like a machine. In the biography example, after he invented a computer and got it running after the Second World War, the input and output to the computer was punch tape. So the punch was hexadecimal notation. So they were doing problems like factoring large numbers and things of this kind. And Turing would stamp, put the problem in with his punch tape, and this machine would run it and spit out a bunch of punch tape with hexadecimals on it. And Turing would stand there as the hexadecimals came out of the machine and feel them with his fingers. So, okay, I know the answer. And some other people complained in this lab, complained. They said, you know, I can't read hexadecimals by touch. Turing said, why not? Just a question of paying attention. It's an interesting comment on user friendliness, I think, of computer systems. If you think your computer is not user friendly, they've come a long way from the Turing. Okay, so Turing, anyway, thought of, he was trying to make a general model of how he might operate if he were an ideal machine. And his idea was, well, what I need is someplace to write stuff down, because I've got to make marks. So he had the idea that there would be a tape, and the machine had a head, and the head would be over one location on the tape at any moment. And the head could do several things. It could read whatever symbol was on the tape, or it could change the symbol on the tape. And then it, depending on what symbol it read from the tape, it could move the tape one space to the right or one space to the left and see what the next symbol was. Pretty simple, but it turns out that it actually includes all modern digital computers. But there is a particular state of the machine, and when the machine reads a symbol, it may change its own internal state so that its reaction to the next symbol is not the same as it would have been if it read some different symbol. So you see, it's really a pretty sophisticated and general idea. The Turing machine starts in a certain state with the head located at a particular position on a tape, and the tape contains a finite input string of symbols. So that's the program, as it were. And in each cycle, the head reads the symbol on the tape. Maybe it writes a different symbol in its place, moves left or right, and it shifts the machine to another state. And then this keeps going on. But there's one particular state of the machine that's called the halting state. So if the machine gets into this halting state, it stops. And then whatever is on the tape is the result of the computation. So given an input string X, a particular Turing machine, which we might call M, may halt after some number of operations with an output string, which we'll call Y, which we can symbolize as the result of the machine M operating on the input string X on the tape. On the other hand, and this is why the Turing machine is equivalent to the Gödel kind of approach, a given Turing machine may never halt on some inputs. For example, it may be that the given Turing machine, what it does, you just give it a tape with two symbols, and its program is read the first symbol. Let's say it's this statement is true. It means this statement is true. And the Turing machine shifts to, changes that to this statement is false, and moves one square to the right, where the symbol says this statement is false, and it changes that to this statement is true, and moves one square to the left, and you know that's an endless loop that's never going to stop. The machine's just going to keep going and going and going, because it always has the instruction to do something different. So you definitely have a class of inputs on which a Turing machine may not halt. Turing used this concept of the Turing machine to attack Hilbert's question. But he had to make a very important assumption, which we want to keep in mind in the background of this whole discussion, which is called now called the Church-Turing thesis. And the Church-Turing thesis is not exactly a mathematical assumption, nor is it a theorem. It's really a philosophical guess or principle on the basis of which a lot of this discussion takes place. The Turing thesis is that any systematic procedure for ascertaining the truth or falsehood of a mathematical proposition could be represented abstractly by coding the proposition as an input to a Turing machine and then seeing whether the Turing machine would halt. Now that philosophical proposition is much more open-ended because it says any systematic procedure can be reduced to this kind of Turing machine. For example, there is some question as to whether neuronal networks of mammalian brains can decide some propositions that Turing machines can't. That's one example. There are also examples of what are called analog computers. In fact, there are many wonderful problems that can be solved very simply by analog devices. Which cannot be solved by digital computers, which have no stopping. Jose, we have a... Well, wait, let's see if we can get you the microphone. I know it was... Thank you.
Just a clarified question. So that basically, that thesis will imply that all of these statements are computable in that sense?
It says, well, I tried to say it as precisely as I could. The thesis is that the Turing machine is effectively as powerful as any other device that human beings have at their disposal. And it might be true, it might not be. I gave the example of the brain or quantum computers. I mean, the quantum computer is different from the Turing machine or other or analog computers of various kinds are other devices to solve these kinds of problems. Turing showed that there were some propositions that could not be decided by any Turing machine because of the possibility that the machine would never halt given that proposition as input. And one, it's a very nice example, one such undecidable proposition, which gives you a counterexample to Hilbert's theory, is will a Turing machine, a particular Turing machine, reach the halting state on any arbitrary input? And you can give a proof by contradiction, a very simple proof by contradiction of this idea. So you can propose a particular input in a particular Turing machine that no other Turing machine could possibly answer whether it would halt or not. The basic idea is it's self-referential. So you say, well, the Turing machine that I'm going to use is effectively the one that's referred to here, and if it could predict whether it itself would halt, you know, you get a contradiction in that way. Okay. He also proved that there were universal Turing machines that could emulate the operation of any Turing machine. And the idea here is pretty simple. You just start with a tape that programs your particular Turing machine to act like the universal Turing machine to behave as if it were some other particular Turing machine. So this is the principle of emulation that's used a lot in computer programming, where you make one computer act as if it's another computer because it has a program in it that makes it act as if it were some other computer. Now, we will detour back from the Turing machine to the point of trying to figure out a prior for theories. One way to think of the Turing machine is as a device for transforming one input string, maybe a short input string, into another, perhaps much longer output string. For example, suppose that my program says, print the digits 0, 1, or the bits 0, 1, 100 times. Now, I can write that as a very short program because I just have to put the 0, 1 in and code the number 100, and the Turing machine just chugs it along. But instead of a short beginning, I get a big long 100 or 1,000 or million bit string. So you can think of it in that way. Andrei Kolmogorov proposed to define the complexity of a data string as the length of the shortest input program to a universal Turing machine that would lead the machine to halt with the data string on the tape. So for example, if my data string happened to consist of 100 copies 01010101, then a good candidate for the shortest input string would be that program that says just write 01 100 times, right? Which is much shorter. So you would say that's not a very complicated string. And you would be right, because it has so much structure, 0101. All it is the same thing over and over and over again. You can describe it in words or a whole, you know, it's very easy to understand. This property of a string is also called its algorithmic information content, the AIC. And it's often denoted by the function k for Kolmogorov of x. So k of x we want to think of as, in principle, the shortest input string that I can put on my universal Turing machine, which will generate my data string as the output. Well, you can see this is also a kind of compression, right? If the data string can be reproduced by a very short program, then why bother communicating the whole data string? You just send me the program and I put it on my universal Turing machine, and if I care about it, I can reproduce the data string as much as I want to, or any part of it, or whatever. So in that case, it seems right that a string with very small algorithmic information content has low complexity, or low, as it, you know, can be summarized very shortly, can be compressed a lot. Ray Solomonoff, actually writing before Kolmogorov, proposed the idea of explaining data strings by constructing a Turing machine that could reproduce the string. So he had exactly the same idea. And he proposed to use the, Solomonoff proposed to use the algorithmic information content as the basis of a universal prior over hypotheses in a Bayesian sense. So for Solomonoff, the universal prior of a hypothesis or a theory is proportional to 2 to the negative of the Kolmogorov complexity of that theory. That is, what's the shortest program that does this theory? Say, computes ellipses if you're Kepler, or finds the linear relation between income and consumption if you're a Keynesian economist. Okay, and Solomonoff said, well, he likes short, simple theories in the sense of theories that can be explained by a program, by a computer program that's short and simple, doesn't have a lot of data. It doesn't have to have a lot of data. Okay, as I said, Kolmogorov suggested using the AIC itself as the measure of the complexity of any data string, but, and that seems right when you think about cases like short pattern repetition, because anything that's a short pattern repetition you can regenerate very easily. But consider a string that's completely random in the sense that it has no regular features at all. Now, this is a little bit hand-waving and could argue about whether any such string really exists or it has to be an infinite string or something. But let me just appeal to your intuition. The only way to produce that type, reproduce that type of string, is to put the whole thing as the input tape on the universal Turing machine, with the instruction to just sit there. Okay? So you have to just copy the whole data string. So we're back effectively to the beginning of the talk, where you were trying to send me your data. If your data is completely random and structureless, then you have no choice but just to send it to me bit by bit, which is going to cost you the log to the 2 of n bits. But this program results in no compression of the random data string at all. So from Kolmogorov's point of view, a random data string would be very complex. Now, people like Gell-Mann and Seth Loy rebelled against that. They said, no, that's not right. A completely random data string also is not very complex. It has no information in it. So there's something wrong with the AIC itself, just by itself, as a measure of the complexity of the amount of information that's in data. And you can see where they're going, because they were physicists. And from the physics point of view, they're saying, look, the motion of the planets, Brahe's record of the motion of the planets, looked kind of random, right? I mean, moving around back and forth. But when Kepler got hold of them and said, well, suppose we try to plot these on ellipses, then all of a sudden it doesn't look so random. And in fact, you can begin to see that by just knowing the dimensions of the ellipses, you know a whole lot about the motion of the planets. For Gell-Mann and Seth Lloyd, something like Brahe's data was what we really mean by complex, that is, interesting data. It's data that has a structure, but a kind of hidden structure. It requires some effort to untangle it or find out what it is. Some bright person like Kepler or Murray Gell-Mann or Seth Lloyd has to apply their mind to it to figure out how to encode this data. Their model, which is very much influenced by statistical mechanics, so it's close to some of the ideas that we've been talking about entropy-constrained models, they define a hypothesis as specifying frequencies over the set of all possible data strings of a given length n. And that's what they call an ensemble. So for them, an ensemble is a collection of data strings together with a set of frequencies, a frequency assigned to each data string. That's very much like the Shannon model, except instead of messages, well, we've called the data strings messages. We're looking at them as messages. So it's almost exactly the same idea. In their setup, the complexity of the data string is the length of the shortest program for a universal Turing machine that computes the frequencies of the ensemble that best represents the data string. Such a program takes as its input a particular data string and halts with the frequency the ensemble assigns to that string on the tape. So they're making a transition from regenerating the data string to generating the probability of the or frequency of the data string in a particular ensemble. Now, think about what that means. For example, a data string consisting of a short repeated pattern corresponds to an ensemble that gives the frequency 1 to the string consisting of the repeated pattern and 0 to every other string. Well, what kind of program do you write on that case? Well, you write a program that says, okay, show me your string. Here, the first is zero, the second is one. Okay, you're okay so far. The next one better be zero. Okay. Next one better be one. Next one better be zero. Next one better be one. And it just keeps going until it's not right, until it sees something that's not right. And then it puts a frequency of zero on that. It says, no, that's not one of the, that's not a valid string. If it gets through the whole string and it really is all 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, it gives the frequency 1. It says, yes, that's certainly the that's certainly a member of this ensemble. Well, what happens with a completely random, patternless string? It corresponds to an ensemble that gives an equal probability to all strings of the same length, because it has no information in it that distinguishes it from anything else except the number of bits. That's the only thing. It's the only property of it. The program to do that, however, is also very short, since if we're interested in that ensemble, the uniform ensemble, it just consists of the length of the data string and the instruction to assign the frequency 2 to the minus n to every input string, string of the right length. Well, that's also a very short program, right? Not doing any complex analysis or correlations or autocorrelation or serial correlation of the bits or any stuff like that. You're just saying, okay, you got a million bits there. As far as I'm concerned, you might as well have had any other string of a million bits. This theory can't tell you anything about that. And this insight is quite nice because it says the complexity in this sense, which is what they call effective complexity, the complexity in this sense of a simple pattern string, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, is very low because it has you can assign it into ensembles with a short program. But the complexity of completely patternless strings is also very low, because the best you can do is to assign the uniform probability over it. So what we're interested in then, and this is a very, I think, very helpful bit of thing to think about probably before you go to sleep at night. Do not try to think about it when you're sitting down and with your econometrics program and trying to write a paper, because you'll just involute and get farther and farther away from writing the paper. But you know, you might think a little bit, because what it says is what's interesting data is data that has some structure, so it is compressible. There's some principle or some property that these strings have that you can detect somehow. You can write a program to detect this property and use that to assign probabilities in a way that shortens up the coding a lot. Now, as we've seen, I did not get this for a long time. I spent a couple of years going out to Santa Fe and trying to talk to Murray Gell-Mann about this. I kept saying, well, look, isn't the simplest thing, I'm just going to always have two classes. Either the string fits the class or it doesn't fit the class, and it's going to be like the 1-0 operation. And he said, when I finally explained this to him, which took a while, he said, oh, you're not thinking about the constraints. Said, I'm not thinking about the constraints. So I thought about that for about another year, and then I realized what he meant. because we've seen this in many of the examples of this course, right? You maximize entropy subject to constraints, right? There, like in the statistical mechanics, the distribution of the energies of the particles, the exponential distribution of the energy of the particles, is the maximum entropy distribution, not without any constraints, only when the constraint is that the energy has to be non-negative and that you know the mean energy, right? Which is effectively the same as knowing the temperature. If you drop that constraint, first of all, if you drop that constraint, we know that there is no maximum entropy distribution, right? We saw that at the very beginning of the class. You always want to spread the frequency thinner and thinner over the whole unbounded real line. You put another constraint on, like it has like a maximum and a minimum, then you get a maximum entropy distribution, which is the uniform distribution, and so forth. So for Gell-Mann, the whole point of it is constraints. So in economics, it might be the total economic surplus, or we saw this in terms of the profit rate data that I showed you from Ellis Scharfnaker and Gregor. Okay, yeah, Juan.
I just would like to know if you could comment a little bit of how would this work in a theory that has time? Like, how would the complexity of the system change if, for example, if it's a long-run theory? I would say it's the one that it has the lowest complexity. And the forces that would take you there, that would give you some other kind of degree of how complex the system is. Could you comment a little bit on these kind of problems?
Okay, Juan says, can I comment on what happens when time gets involved? And there's many things to say about that, but let me try to give a fairly short answer, and if it's not satisfactory, we can talk about it some more. At one level, we know that, let's say the data string is dynamic. The example I gave you, say Tycho Brahe's observations, are dynamic, right? Each observation corresponds to a particular time of where Jupiter is, or whichever planet he's looking at. And the elliptical motion, the idea that the planet is in motion on an elliptical orbit around the sun, is a dynamical idea. But the data treats it as static, right? I mean, the data just sits there. And what Kepler finds is that hidden in the data is this correlation, which can be most easily visualized or expressed in terms of the of the motion of the planet around the elliptical orbit. Same thing would be true in economic data. If you take a time series, say the data is time series, and it's some kind of autoregressive process. Well, you know you can compress autoregressive processes a lot, right? Because they are, you know a lot about the data from the history of it, so you can compress it quite a lot in that way. Let me, however, shift gears slightly on the political economy thing. Let's think about classical political economy and the market prices and the natural prices, because you were mentioning the idea of long run. Well, it seems to me that's exactly the same thing. The insight, they didn't talk about it in terms of data compression, but their insight was an insight of data compression. They said, look, you go out there and you measure price, you look at what prices are, they're jumping around all over the place, right? So that's our data string, is all this big, and it might look at first glance as though it's a completely random structuralist string, right? But it's not, because of the phenomenon of natural prices. that the natural prices are precisely this kind of hypothesis that allowed them to compress the information in the market price data by saying, well, what it really is a fluctuation around these centers of gravitation, the natural prices, and it's much simpler then for me to communicate to you, okay, here's the natural prices of the system. If you know that, you know a lot already. In fact, that might be all you really need to know if you're interested only in long-run properties, right? And then I'm going to tell you, if I need to tell you the market prices, I can do them much more efficiently, code them much more efficiently in terms of deviations from the natural prices. Does that help the respond to the question? Okay. I think maybe we should take a little break and come back in not very long, okay, because there's a fair amount more to go here. Here we are back, and I'll try to go through a little bit more of this. If we try to analyze what a Turing machine that's doing this would actually do, here's what it would have to look like. So this is analyzing this in terms of program, basic programming, sort of simple programming. The program accepts a data string of a given length m. So it's got a certain number of bits as input, and it's going to assign it to one of j bins. So it's going to somehow this program looks at this data, and it says, what kind of data is this? And depending on what kind of data it is, it puts it in one of these bins. For example, if you're thinking about linear regression, let's say the data comes in the form of a bunch of pairs, x and y pairs, or more than one x. But let's just keep with x and y. So you can look at it on a scatter plot, right? Then a program corresponding to a certain linear model that has a certain intercept and a certain slope would say, what's the likelihood of this particular data given the hypothesis that I as the program represent, that is a certain intercept and slope. And it would compute that, let's say, by finding the standard deviation of the errors, from the prediction. It would put all data strings that have the same standard deviation of error in the same box, in the same bin. And effectively, then, it says, well, we can't tell the difference among those. Those are all just the same from the point of view of the program. If you get a bigger standard error, it puts it in another bin. So you're going to have to what's called coarse grain the standard error, so that, which the computer has to do, because the computer only has finite precision. So it can't distinguish real numbers like the standard deviations of the data to any infinite precision. So it's going to have to do this kind of thing. So it assigns it to a bin. Then the ensemble program, so this is the first part of the program. It's the part of the program that analyzes the data in some meaningful way that is represented by the theory. And the ensemble program assigns a frequency fj to each bin. If there are nj strings assigned to bin j, well, you can see that the smaller the standard deviation, actually the smaller the number of strings of a certain precision are going to be assigned to that bin. each string in the bin has the frequency fj, which is just dividing up the frequency of the bin over the examples. Why? Because the program can't tell the difference between the strings that it puts in the same bin. Or the theory, let's say, cannot tell the difference. Each string x will have one or more properties represented by the value of some possibly vector-valued function. For example, energy or income. So maybe the string, this data string is the record of a whole bunch of household income data, what the wages of the household were. And we know, let's say our theory is that the average income has to be a certain number. Think about it that way, which is going to give us an exponential maximum entropy distribution of wage income, which turns out not to be so bad a approximation of what you actually see in the distribution of wage incomes. So the frequencies have to satisfy certain constraints of this type, that fjxj over njx times g of x is equal to some mean number, like the mean income, or maybe a mean income and a variance of income, or maybe more constraints of that kind. Or, as we've seen, if lurking in the theory is quantal maximization, that is entropy-constrained maximization, then a constraint would also be on the expected payoff, let's say, or some dimension of the expected payoff. Because in that sense, I've tried to argue, purposeful behavior in social science is just like a constraint in natural science. The particles in the gas don't know what the total energy of the system is, right? The competing capitalists in the profit rate model do know what the profit rate is, and they're out to get the highest profit rate they can by moving their capital around. Right? So that, but from a formal point of view, those two situations are exactly the same. It also tells you that the content of the theory, from this point of view, is in these constraints. This is the other point that Gell-Mann was making to me. You don't have a theory. The theory of maximum entropy by itself is no theory at all. It's only when you add constraints to represent your what you think is going on or what you hypothesize might be going on, like profit rate maximization or in the Keynesian model, model of Bertrand competition. It's only when you add constraints of that kind that you get a theory that has some empirical explanatory power. How long is the program to compute the frequencies of an ensemble representing a theory H? Well, you can think of that program as having two parts. First of all, it has to have a sorting routine to put any given input string into a bin. To try to make this more concrete, if this program is representing statistical mechanics as a theory of a gas, of a perfect gas, and the data is the momenta and the position of all the particles in the gas, if you could observe it. Of course, you can't really observe it, but we think of that as the example. Then what the program does is it computes the energy of that ensemble. And that's the key discovery of statistical physics. The key discovery was that the energy was the unlocked the whole structure of the gas system. For example, suppose you just said, well, I'm going to maximize entropy subject to the mean position of the particle. So you have this box, and their mean position is somewhere in the middle of the box. you get a terrible theory. You don't get anything like the actual pressure-volume relations that you see in gases. That's just like I gave you the example of in the profit rate, where we started off just maximizing subject to the constraint of the total surplus value and the total capital. You get a terrible theory. It doesn't look anything like the actual distribution of profit rates. Does that mean you're using the wrong method? No. It means that you don't have the right constraints to represent the right theory. And it may take a very long time. If you look at the history of physics, it was not instantly apparent to many very bright physicists that energy was the thing that was conserved. And that once you realized that energy was both conserved and was non-negative, then you maximize entropy subject to the energy constraint, and you get the right answer, or very close to the right answer. You realize you're on the right track. Okay, so the first part is this sorting routine. So that has to do with the insight that we have into what's going on in the situation, because it focuses our attention on those dimensions of the situation. We have to transform the description of the data into the relevant framework, like energy in the case of statistical mechanics, or income, it turns out, in the case of works, in the case of income distribution. Okay, and then a second part of the program has to assign a frequency to each bit. So we can think of the ensemble as a collection of two things. One, the bins, say different energy levels or different income levels. And second, the frequencies that we assign to each of those bins. And the algorithmic information content of the whole ensemble is therefore the sum of these two programs, of the length of these two programs. The first program is whatever you have to do to figure out what it is, which might be very subtle and very complicated. Might mean that you have to find out really long correlation, you know, long distance correlations in the data if it's time series data or something. Or other subtle points. And then the assignment of the frequencies to the bins. But you've got to assign the frequencies to the bins in such a way that that you meet the constraints. So you're maximizing, well, okay. Note that programs that compute the same binning but in a different order will be of the same length, because it really doesn't matter which order we number the bins in. Thus, we have freedom without loss of generality to choose ensembles that put the data string in the first bin. So the convention is that the data string always gets put in the first bin, and you'll see why that's important in a moment. I've got to keep moving right along here. The likelihood of the data string given an ensemble E that assigns the data string to its first bin is just 1 over N1. It's just the number 1 over the number of strings that are put into that bin. So clearly, it's very nice to put the data string as much as possible in a bin all by itself, or with only a very few other similar ones that we can't tell the difference of. The more we can recognize the data string with this computer program, the more precisely we can recognize it, the better the theory is going to be, because it's going to compress the data a lot more. Of course, if you have to spend a huge number of bits on the program, then you lose, right? Because you may have put the data string in a very small bin, but you have this enormous program that's required to do it. So you have two complex, that's called overfitting. You have too many parameters in the program, and the result is that you think you have a very good fit to the data. You got it in a very small bin. But the fact of the matter is that you've wasted way too much bits on the program. In order to transmit an ensemble as a model of data, we need to transmit both the program to sort strings into bins and the frequencies. Then we can specify the exact string losslessly by transmitting an integer representing its position in some ordering of the strings in the first bin. Okay, so we do this ensemble model. You know the string is in the first bin. Maybe that's enough. Maybe that's all you care about. You know what the energy of the string is, because you don't really care which configuration of the gas it is as long as you know the energy level, right? But maybe you really care what the, you know, exactly where the particles are. Then you're going to have to convey more information to separate out all the different possible microstates that correspond to that macrostate. Now, how are we going to transmit the ensemble frequency? Well, we're going to need to code it in some way, right? So for each ensemble frequency, now frequency is a distribution over the ensembles, corresponding to a prior probability over frequencies. Now, this looks a lot like Bayesianism, right? Because now we're, okay, and a natural way to do this, and I put natural in scare quotes for a reason, because nothing is really that simple, but okay, I'm trying to introduce you to this, these ideas. One natural way to code frequency distributions is to code them relative to their entropy. Okay, so I have a high entropy distribution. I give it a very short code word. I have a low entropy distribution. I have to give it a very long code word. Now, that's not the only way. It might be that I could code them the other way and give very low entropy distributions short code words and the high entropy distributions long code words. And that's going to make a difference to the theory, a big difference to the theory. And whether the minimizing entropy or maximizing entropy does better is going to depend to some degree on what the structure of the data is. I mean, you know, it's not, maximizing entropy is not a universal principle for figuring out. It just works really well a lot of the time. And we're beginning to see why it works so well so much of the time. So if we apply this idea to the two-part codes, what does it tell us? It says the posterior probability of a hypothesis given data, which was the original log thing that I showed you, where the hypothesis is now an ensemble. So it's a combination of sorting the data strings into categories and assigning probabilities or frequencies to those categories, and puts the data string in the first bin, we get the posterior probability that the total length of the code word now to transmit the data, which is the negative of the log of the posterior probability, consists of what? Well, it consists of the algorithmic information content of the bin sorting routine. How big a computer program do you need to distinguish the bins? Second, the log of the number of bins, because that's part of the information you need to know, plus the entropy of the frequency distribution. So that means that if I'm going to maximize the, and then there's a residual entropy, which is the logarithm of the size of the first bin where the data string gets put. Might like to get that small. Maybe you don't even care about that particularly. And this is why you maximize entropy, if from this point of view. Holding constant your model in the sense of sorting the strings out and the number of, and the coarse graining, the number of different bins you're putting the data in, you would like to maximize the entropy of the probability distribution that you assign to the different bins, because that's a way of maximizing the compression, the data compression that this scheme is going to give you. Okay, well, let me give a couple of examples to try to make this a little clearer. The one from statistical mechanics that's helpful is Gibbs's canonical ensemble. He used the term ensemble. For data representing the state of a mechanical system, say a gas of identical molecules, in thermal equilibrium with a heat bath, but otherwise isolated. So that means the system can exchange energy with this heat bath, but it can't change the number of particles, and it can't change its volume, the volume of the container, or anything like that. The system, the energy can vary and will vary because the system is in contact with this heat bath. So it can give out energy to the heat bath or take in energy from the heat bath. We do know that if the heat bath is very large relative to the system, that the temperature of the system, the shadow price of energy in the isolated system, is going to have to come into equilibrium with the heat bath. Right? That's the basic principle of thermodynamic equilibrium. Data strings in this example are sorted into bins according to their energy. So if I'm trying to describe the configuration of the molecules, any configuration, I calculate its energy, which is actually not very hard to do. That's a fairly, because you just, I mean, energy is 1/2 mv squared. The kinetic energy is just 1/2 mv squared. So you can compute that with a little subroutine that just does a couple multiplications, right? And you just have to do that on all of the whole data string over and over again. But repeating a subroutine over and over again doesn't make the program any longer. Right? Because you just are using the same code, reusing the same code over and over again. The ensemble we consider all put the data string state into the first bin. So that's just a convention. In this case, the constraint is the mean energy constraint. We're supposed to know the mean energy, which is effectively the same as knowing the temperature. The shortest code length through the frequency will correspond to maximizing entropy subject to this constraint, which is the basic principle of statistical mechanics. And the residual entropy is just the number of states with energy levels corresponding to the energy level of the data stream, since those are the other ones that are put in, that the program puts into the same category. This, you can read a little bit about the history of statistical physics, but the this is one of the gigantic achievements of the human mind, that people figured this out. And it's the basis of a huge part of science, astronomy, physics, rocket design, biology, immense amount is basically this, just this scheme, maybe with appropriate changes. Well, one appropriate change would be to change from energy to income, for example, to earned income, for example, or some of these other wealth or other ensembles that we are familiar with in economics that show these kinds of statistical regularities. Now, this is not a recipe or a cookbook for solving scientific problems. And it is not and if you're going to drive yourself nuts if you try to do this as your way of doing your thesis research or something. After you've had a beer or something and you're going to sleep and you're in the half awake state. Great, that this is great stuff to think about, and it will help your unconscious mind. But it's really not a very good heuristic. Okay, the heuristic has to depend on your insight into the actual economics or social interaction of whatever it is that you're working on. But it's also important to realize some formal things about it. First of all, there's no effective procedure to maximize posterior probability over ensemble theories. If they were, we could set computers to doing scientific research. But they can't, because the algorithmic information content of a set of bins is not computable. And the reason for that is the halting problem. We might try to compute K of X by enumerating all the programs of a given length for a UTM to see if any of them achieve the sorting. Could try that. But what's going to happen is some of those programs may not halt in any finite time. The maddening thing about the halting problem is you're sitting there and you're waiting, and if the program's halted, great, okay, that one you've got. But if it hasn't halted, you don't know whether it's never going to halt in the whole history of the universe, or whether you just have to wait one more second and it's going to halt. I mean, you've seen this in computer stuff, right? When is it going to finish? And you just can't tell. So the abstract sorting procedure seems to me to be really the heart of scientific theories, because it establishes the dimensions in which the theory classifies data. And that's the really hard part. And that's why classical political economy, in my view, is such a huge resource. Because they, in fact, did figure out natural prices. And they did figure out the average rate of profit. And they did figure out that it was the rate of profit and the rate of exploitation that were the right things to look at. And as far as I can tell, that's still the right thing to look at. And if you try to create an ensemble from Walrasian general equilibrium theory, well, maybe somebody wants to try that, but it just doesn't fit this way of thinking at all, which the classical political economy and the Marxian extensions of classical political economy do. Curiously enough, the second law of thermodynamics, maximum entropy, appears in the ensemble theory choice analysis in the somewhat unexpected role of a coding scheme for frequency distributions. I don't know what that means exactly. And it seems kind of contingent and conditioned. Maybe in some data, entropy maximization is the way to compress the data the best, but maybe in some other ones, you're better off with the minimum entropy or some other frequency distribution coding scheme. There are actually, if you look into the arcana of entropy lore, you'll find that there are a bunch of other entropies. So the Shannon entropy is not the only one. And I personally think economists can get along with Shannon entropy for quite a while before we have to go to Renyi entropy but you can see why that might be true, because if there's certain kinds of orderliness in the data, it might be that a different coding of the frequency distributions will in fact be better. And therefore, that's the reason for that. So I don't think that the frequency distribution coding is by any means universal. And let me just finally finish up with a little bit about the philosophy of science and thinking about research. This way of looking at it clarifies some potentially puzzling aspects of scientific work. In many cases, the best available theory, in the sense of the ensemble with the maximum posterior probability given the data, we'll classify the data string we have to work with as part of a possibly large class of similar data strings. So it tells you that approximation is probably key to getting anywhere. You cannot hope to explain the exact data. All you can do is find features of the data which put it in some particular class. For example, if the data string is a text of the works of Shakespeare, the best we may be able to do is classify it as a possibly annotated and edited English text of the late 16th and early 17th century, along with a whole bunch of other stuff, variants, all the different ways there might have been misprints in this book, or and so forth. The variants may differ in spelling, exact word choice, inclusion or exclusion of certain works, typographic errors, and so forth. Thus, we inherently perceive reality as represented by a data string as a somewhat fuzzy collection of possible alternatives. And this is a theme of neuroscience, actually. And it runs back to the quantal response. The quantal responders are seeing the choice in a fuzzy way, right? And when the bond price gets to a very small range, it's very hard for them to distinguish different bond prices, say in the liar's poker case. So the whole idea of the progress of science from this point of view is that you're going to finer and finer grained sorting of possible data strings, but you've got to be careful not to pay too much in terms of the complexity of the theory or the program. And I don't know if you've noticed this, but many of these extremely successful theories, the theory part is very simple. Really very simple. This slide talks about a version of this that also appears in neuroscience, but let me wind up. So you're trying to make a contribution to knowledge. So you might think about it in terms of this general framework. It's not going to be helpful for most of us to fashion research programs directly with the ensemble theory in mind, because it's just too abstract, really. What are the moments of scientific advance? Well, one is data. So a collection of data is definitely part of it. But you'll notice that data tends to be coarse-grained by human common sense and experience as well as by existing theoretical ensembles. This is the idea that there's no such thing as a raw fact. There's only a fact that comes through. So we don't see human behavior, economic behavior, we see prices people pay, quantities that they buy, their balance sheets, you know, items like that, right? This can be either a hindrance or a help. For example, the prior influence of Aristotelian categories in many sciences led to long periods of scientific stagnation because new data was pigeonholed in obsolete and irrelevant categories. And as long as you're stuck using that bad program, it's very hard to get anywhere. The fit doesn't get any better. You don't really see where Jupiter is or anything. But the pure collection of data is of inherently limited interest unless the data is so novel and surprising as to require a major revision of the ensemble representing current theory. So this is why theory has a certain prestige compared to pure data collection in science and social science. Innovations in the ensemble theory in the bidding program are much more far-reaching. So if you can get anywhere on that, that's dynamite. If you see a dimension in which you think the data can be reorganized that people don't know about, that's really great, but that's very hard to do. On the other hand, it's possible to spend a lot of time and effort spinning elegant theories, those with relatively short programs, that do not wind up contributing much or anything to the compression of the data. They just aren't right. They're great theory, but they don't help with the data. Occam's razor is one blade of theoretical scissors, the other blade of which has to be this idea of overall data compression and the trade-off between the complexity of the theory and the fit of the data. And keeping alive this dialectical interchange between data compression and theory is a very hard thing to do, but it's what keeps research programs alive. So I think that is the end of the class and the end of the course.